how do you feel about going to space? And no, I don't mean studying astrophysics in the womb, then dedicating 50 years of your life to rocket propulsion, then hoping you're the 0.0001% of applicants who get accepted by NASA. I mean, what if you could go on your computer and book a ticket, then go to space? Well, that's exactly what a company by the name of Virgin Galactic is proposing: commercialized spaceflight for the average person. Well, that is the average person with around $250,000 lying around. For science, of course. Now, while this all may sound like a science fiction fantasy, it's actually not as far off as you think. Because over the past decade, Virgin Galactic has already been working on innovative aircraft and spacecraft to get us there, and have already completed multiple successful test flights to space. So what exactly does a spacecraft look like, and how is it designed, and how does it work? And what does a flight to space actually feel like? Well, we're gonna unpack all of that in this video, so let's get started. Thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. If you want both a fun and interactive way to brush up on your math and physics skills like I did for this video, then check out the link in the description. Virgin Galactic was founded back in 2004 by two pretty legendary figures in aviation, Burt Rutan and Richard Branson. Of course, Burt Rutan is a brilliant aircraft designer, specializing in building light, efficient, and often strange-looking aircraft. He designed the Rutan Voyager back in the 80s, becoming the very first plane to circumnavigate the globe without stopping or refueling. He went on to found Scaled Composites, a company specializing in building prototype airplanes out of composite materials as opposed to metal. And you know what? A history of Burt Rutan's life could be a long video in and of itself, but all you need to know is the man is great at designing planes. On the other hand, Richard Branson is no rookie either, because back in the 70s, he founded the Virgin Group, which today encompasses over 400 companies in various different fields, including, of course, the very famous Virgin Atlantic airline. So in 2004, with Rutan's aircraft knowledge and with Branson's business experience, the duo teamed up to create Virgin Galactic, the very first commercial spaceflight company. Well, that was the hope anyway. The idea is that one day, the average consumer can just hop onto a spacecraft, fly up into space for a little bit, then come back to Earth in just a matter of hours. Just like how today we pay for rides at amusement parks, just at a very, very large scale, and at a hefty price tag too. But we'll get into that later on. The company says its eventual goal is to establish Earth-orbiting hotels and science labs, and eventually full space exploration. But let's come back to Earth for a little bit, because how are they actually going to accomplish this? Because right now, the company is barely past making the first step. And what is that first step? Well, making some flying machines. For the purpose of getting humans to space, at least temporarily, Virgin Galactic has designed a nifty little two-craft system. It consists of a mothership aircraft called WhiteKnightTwo that carries the actual spacecraft called SpaceShipTwo up to an altitude of about 50,000 feet to give it a little boost. SpaceShipTwo then separates from the mothership and, using the propellant it carries, completes that journey to the edge of the Earth's atmosphere. Then, as gravity pulls SpaceShipTwo back to Earth, it re-enters the atmosphere, then serves as a glider to land on its own back at the base. So first, let's dive a little deeper into the engineering of the mothership, the WhiteKnightTwo. The WhiteKnightTwo is a four-engine, dual-fuselage jet aircraft that flew initially back in 2010. It was actually intended to be a multi-purpose aircraft and not just the mothership, because with a service ceiling of around 70,000 feet, the engineers replicated the interior of SpaceShipTwo on one of the two fuselages so that it could serve as a training aircraft for tourists to practice on before the real flight. And the other fuselage, well, allegedly, it's going to be used as an economy class trip to bring passengers to the stratosphere, which is basically space. I mean, close enough. Well, at least in this case, economy class is going to get a perk that first class will never get, and that is beverage service. The WhiteKnightTwo also allegedly has a pretty impressive turnaround time. It's able to complete 4 flights daily during both day and night with its very advanced avionics system. And just as important is the second part of the system, the part that will actually get you into space, and it's called SpaceShipTwo. SpaceShip Two is a reusable winged spacecraft that can carry 8 people, including 2 pilots. Its fuselage is 3.7 meters long and 2.3 meters in diameter, like the interior of a slightly oversized car. The spaceship has a single hybrid engine, and what that means is that it has both a solid motor, which is more simple with less moving parts, and also a liquid motor with better control. This engine, very creatively named Rocket Motor 2, produces around 60,000 pound-force of thrust, around 50% more than an engine on the F-35. One of the many groundbreaking aspects of Space Shuttle 2 is its feathered re-entry system, where it can rotate its wing backwards and actually create a shuttlecock effect on re-entry. This enables the aircraft to achieve more aerodynamic drag to slow down while lowering the thermal loads on re-entry. Now, it's able to accomplish this because of its relatively low re-entry speed. This is especially in comparison to other spacecraft that re-enter at much higher orbital speeds, like the Space Shuttle, which need to rely on heat shields on re-entry. The aircraft is also allegedly so safe that it can re-enter the atmosphere at any angle, and it will self-correct to land safely, even in the event of a catastrophic failure. Now again, this is allegedly. Following re-entry, the spacecraft essentially acts as a glider and lands back to Earth on its own. And during landing, it can even change its shape to adjust its stability and also rate of descent by twisting a little bit of the wings and the tail booms. And if you're curious about what happened to White Knight 1 and Spaceship 1, well, they were much smaller versions with lower payload capacities that eventually acted as a prototype for building the later models that we see today. So, okay, we get how the hardware systems work, but what would I actually experience as a private astronaut on Spaceship 2? Well, before that, actually, you gotta get in line. After the 8,000 people who've already signed up for a flight. And not only that, it will cost you a pretty penny too. Virgin Galactic has raised the price for a ticket from $200,000 to $250,000. And allegedly, at this point, some travelers were even asked to take a 6 to 8G centrifuge test to qualify. And when the logistics are all taken care of, you'll be ready to enroll in a 3-day training course at the Virgin Galactic spaceport in New Mexico. This is where you'll receive guidance from the senior astronauts on, well, how to be an astronaut, and about the systems on board. You'll also receive from medical consultants a nutrition and fitness program. But can I just take a second to say that trying to help people get fit enough to go to space in 3 days is like me thinking I'll get bikini ready by running through the airport on my way to Cancun. It's not gonna happen. But once you're past all the paperwork and the checks, you're finally ready to fly. So you'll be strapped into Spaceship 2 attached to White Knight 2, and soon you'll be reaching an altitude of 50,000 feet. And minutes later, you're released from the mothership and you enter into a glide. But no need to panic, because just a few seconds later, the rocket motor will fire, entering the spacecraft into a vertical climb, soon reaching a top speed of Mach 3.5. And during this acceleration, you'll experience around 3.5 Gs. After just 70 seconds from the initial ejection, the engines would be shut off and the spacecraft continues to climb using its remaining momentum. At this point, very close to peak altitude, you start to experience weightlessness in microgravity for around 6 minutes. This usually happens right above what is called the Kármán line, a distance of 100 kilometers or 330,000 feet above sea level, typically considered to be the boundary between Earth and space. Then, as gravity starts pulling the spacecraft back to Earth, the crew actually needs to change the wing configuration to be feathered for re-entry. And after re-entry at around 50,000 feet, the wings are put back into their normal position so that the plane can be a glider to land back at the spaceport in just around 25 minutes. And this entire process took around 2.5 hours. Now, you may have noticed that throughout this video, there weren't a lot of mentions of any dates, and that's because all of this is still undergoing testing as we speak, and it's aimed to be released sometime in the future. And as is the norm in aviation, deadlines have been getting pushed back and back and back some more. Today in 2020, there has already been multiple successful space test flights that were conducted, but there still doesn't seem to be any end in sight just yet. And a major roadblock for the schedule was a tragic accident that occurred back in October of 2014, when during a test flight, SpaceShip Two broke apart in midair. During the crash, unfortunately, the co-pilot was killed and the pilot was seriously injured. After investigations, the NTSB cited inadequate design safeguards, poor pilot training, lack of rigorous FAA oversight, and a potentially anxious co-pilot without recent flight experience as important factors in this 2014 crash. Investigators later concluded that the source of the crash was due to the co-pilot prematurely unlocking a movable portion of the tail section as the aircraft was breaking the sound barrier. However, this crash actually exposed a much broader failure of the design, and that was that this single mistake by the co-pilot should have been prevented by some fail-safe system, but instead they rely too heavily on the correct actions of the pilot, a single point of human failure. Following the accident, Virgin Galactic released that they would be fitting the new SpaceShip Twos with a device that would prevent the locking and unlocking of the feather during critical flight phases, and also updated the pilot checklists accordingly. But to me, this kind of feels like a retroactive step, especially since they didn't mention if the entire spacecraft has been modified to eliminate any single point human failures, but I really hope that's the case. And even aside from testing, there are a lot of unknowns here. For example, what does it mean to certify and regulate a spacecraft, and how would we enforce security measures for these private astronauts? Well, these are the answers that we need to eventually answer as they come up. And aside from commercial space tourism, as if that wasn't enough, Virgin Galactic has also recently announced the development of a new orbital launch vehicle for small payloads. This rocket, named Launcher 1, will aim to take packages of around 200 kilograms into orbit. It's stepping into the arena of the likes of SpaceX and United Launch Alliance. Launcher 1 was originally designed to be deployed from WhiteKnightTwo as well, but as the payloads grew heavier and heavier, the duo would no longer be able to reach its original altitude. So instead, a Boeing 747 is being considered for this launch role. And this is still an ongoing project today. Now, to understand some of these concepts sound a little intimidating, it is literally rocket science. In fact, whenever I hear that phrase, my brain just gets triggered a little bit. But a great resource I've been using to make that happen just a little bit less is Brilliant. It's an interactive learning platform for topics in math, science, and engineering. And while researching this video, I actually found their course on gravitational physics. It was a great refresher on the basics. I really enjoyed how engaging their content was. I wasn't just given formulas on paper, but interesting examples of how they apply in real life too, and also quizzes to make sure I'm absorbing the material. And if you're interested in the topic of space travel, I'd highly recommend their astronomy course as well. To learn more about Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/Jenny Ma. You can try it out completely free. And if you like what you see, they're kindly offering a 20% discount off their annual plan for our viewers as well. So guys, there you have it, a little exploration into the space flights of Virgin Galactic and how they work. And what are your thoughts on flying into space? Would you sign up for one? I know for me, the idea sounds really intriguing, but I wouldn't want to be within the first 1,000 people to go up into space. But let me know what your thoughts are in the comments down below. And as always, if you enjoyed this video, please remember to give it a thumbs up. It really helps out the channel. And remember to subscribe for more content. And as always, I will see you guys next week.